So guys, welcome to the second webinar hosted by Exchange to Media. I was thinking the other day, we'll be living in very strange times where boardrooms have been replaced by drawing rooms, where offices have been replaced by work from home setups, professional cameras which were once used to, you know, make films are now giving way to regular mobiles. And even the live events that we had, for that matter, with cameras and boom mics and everything else, like, you know, how as we knew it, have given way to these webinars. So we're literally living in a time created by COVID-19.
Sure.
So this is what we're going to discuss today. I'm Neeta Nair. I'm an assistant editor with Impact Magazine. And let me introduce my panelists. We have Abhishek Gupta, CMO, Edelweiss Tokyo Life Insurance. Saurabh Gadgil, Chairman and MD, PNG Jewelers.
No.
Tarun, Head of Marketing and Products, Skoda Auto India. And Sanjeev Shukla, Group CMO, Muthoot, Pappachan. And we're all here to discuss brand challenges and the road ahead. Also, before that, let me also tell you about our hashtag, e4mWebinar. Please show some love. Please keep tweeting. Let me start with a very basic question. You know, this the COVID-19 outbreak was not exactly a bolt from the blue as far as India is concerned. No, we saw it coming. We saw what was happening in other countries. Tell me, was there any scope for any kind of preparedness as far as the industry is concerned here? Mr. Gupta, can you take this question?
Yeah, so, you know, I agree with you, Neeta, that yes, we saw it coming and could see that it is spreading. However, at the back of our minds, no, there were always some kind of this thing, situations will not come to what it has come to today. It will come and probably it will pass. Probably it will disrupt up to a certain extent, but not up to what it has done. So while yes, we were privy to what was happening and probably we had some time to prepare for it, but nobody would have anticipated that things would come to this. So yes and no would be my answer.
And you know, as a brand, then what was the first step that you took, not as an advertiser, but as a brand, when you realize that there's no going back?
So, you know, especially for our business, which is relies heavily on the advisory model. You know, we are dependent on people, our sales team advising people in what kind of product to buy. And then those advisory meetings are not happening. Face-to-face meetings are not happening. The first and foremost challenge for us to ensure that the confidence level does not go down. You know, if not to meet people, it is not that you're not able to actually do business. So important to ensure that confidence level does not go down. And the second challenge that we also look at that is the, at any point of time, you're talking to a lot of prospects, a lot of people who are looking to buy financial products. And as you know, an insurance product is very much prone to procrastination. Mm-hmm. So at a time where it is very easy for customers and prospects to go away very easily because of this situation, it is important to ensure that the confidence level of the team does not go down. I think our entire focus during the first few days of this situation to ensure that we maintain that confidence level.
Now, let me bring in Mr. Gadgil, maybe. You know, as an advertiser, let me tweak my earlier question and let me tell you, as an advertiser, what was the first step that you took?
Yeah, the advertiser, you know, as a brand, we had to first talk to our customers because this, we are somewhere seeing that things are getting a little worse and we need to get prepared for that. So we had launched as a brand a helpline for customers to really place orders in case the stores get shut down. We had made the entire plan of supply, how these goods will be delivered to them. Since the precious items, gold, diamonds, we had to really be prepared from that perspective. Mm-hmm. And at that point, the lockdown was not officially announced, but there were signs of, you know, things getting a little worse. But after getting prepared for the entire thing, after communicating to customers, in the first 3-4 days, we got more than 7,000 calls from customers with the requirements of, you know, gold jewelry, coins, and being a festive season, being wedding season, people had placed a lot of demands. Unfortunately, before we could assemble everything, lockdown happened. So the first task was to really inform everybody about that we have received your requirement. We are processing it, but we'll not be able to ship it to you until the lockdown is lifted. That was the first communication which I had to give to people. And a lot of people were disappointed because it was Gudi Padwa around the corner. And it was auspicious for them to get something precious in their homes. But we could not honor that. And so even today, people are lining up with their requirements and we are keeping a track of everything. And as soon as, you know, things come to normalcy, we'll be able to honor all the commitment what people have required and be able to fulfill that. On the part of advertising, what we have done is we have tried to portray the brand ethos in communication here. So instead of talking about products, what you're offering, we are talking about how as a brand we have seen worse times than this. Because as you know, PNG has been there from 1832. So similar crisis what had happened 100 years ago, when almost half of the world population had was dead because of the Spanish flu. And that time people had panicked, the end of the world after Second World War. So we're trying to give people hopes. As a brand, we're telling people tough time will not last, and giving people the hopes of how things are going to come back to normalcy. Solving a lot of people's ideas on gold investment. A lot of confusion today in the market about what will happen post COVID lockdown goes up. How will the economy face? What will happen in terms of stock markets, gold investments. So we have set up a dedicated cell where we are answering all these queries of people, communicating to them. And as a brand, we are trying to keep them assured on not to really rely on rumors, fake news, and to look at gold and to look at your jewelry as an investment, look at it as a long-term strategy, and how as a jeweler, we are with them in the entire journey is what we're trying to communicate. This is being done through a lot of mediums. We are using some outdoor mediums for this. We are doing a lot of work on social mediums. So all our social platform, be it Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, we are talking to customers. It's educating as well as trying to answer their queries and to be able to stay in touch with them during these tough times.
Let me try direct my next question to Mr. Jha. I was speaking to a couple of marketers and they told me that for the April-June period, they've slashed spends to the tune of almost 60%. Now, as far as automobile brands are concerned, I mean, it's been a bigger blow for you because you've already been experiencing a slowdown for the past 1 year. So yep. What has the situation been for you as far as advertising is concerned?
See, mass media advertising has been stopped completely because all showrooms are shut, all workshops are shut. People would not even be able to step out of their homes. We had three launches lined up for quarter two. They're still lined up. We are waiting and watching basically to see when this lockdown is lifted because a car launch takes about 3 years of planning. We have to launch the cars, but we will be able to launch it only when things normalize a bit and people are able to step out of their homes and we can ship the cars from the plants to the dealerships and the trucks can move around the country. So as of now, all mass media advertising has been stopped completely. The moment it opens up, we are going to reevaluate. And two things will be critical. One is the mood of the buyer post the lockdown is lifted. And the second thing would be the media consumption patterns, how they change, which will decide how much and where we spend our money.
Okay. Let me bring in Mr. Shukla. Mr. Shukla, are you there?
Hi. Of course.
Okay, so also, there are also brands who have completely withdrawn advertising from a couple of mediums like print, there is radio, and to an extent even TV. But digital is still there. So would you say now all brands are like slowly moving towards digital and digital has finally arrived in India?
Yeah, I think, during the demon period, we saw how payment channels kind of like, using your words, finally arrived. And they've been growing since then. I think, yes, digital has had arrived sometime back. But yes, I would say finally kind of arrived. And all aspects of digital. Just share with you and flip your question, first question. And like Abhishek said, we were not caught unawares. We shouldn't be saying we were caught unawares, but we were really caught I would say lazy, and also the fact that, it's as long as it is not in our neighborhood, it's fine. this too shall pass and so on and so forth. But one of the first things we started, and we've been struggling with that for quite some time, is because we are into lending business primarily, and to the common man who needs money. But so both our people on the ground, which is almost 15,000 people on the ground, and our customers are just too reluctant and not so keen, and don't find it, they find it risky to kind of use digital channels for financial transactions. They use it for everything else, for watching videos and so on and so forth, but not necessarily for digital transactions. By the second week of March itself, even before the Janta curfew and the lockdown and all that happened, we had started communicating on our digital channels to our internal team as well as to customers. You know, please use the app, please use the ePay facility on the website. And we have a product called 24/7, whereby you can SMS and get money. If your loan has headroom, you can get the money in your bank account. You don't have to come to the branch and so on and so forth. So we started doing that mid-March onwards itself. We are hoping, in fact, it has already seen almost a 42% jump in terms of usage. All these three channels put together have seen a 42% jump in the usage in these 2 weeks itself post the lockdown. But still, the overall penetration of digital channels was about 4% of the total pace made. So 42% of us on a smaller base, but we are hoping that this will really catch on as soon as we kind of reopen. And the good part would be that now even our teams on ground are convinced. And as long as they're convinced, hopefully the customers will be convinced.
You know, another thing that we've seen in the past is, you know, movement marketing. You know, a brand like Paytm, I don't think would have thought twice before, you know, using demonetization to their advantage. But at the same time, if one were to say that, you know, somebody wants to exploit COVID, it would be looked upon as a cardinal sin, right? So where does a brand draw the line between informing, promoting itself, and, you know, the rest?
So, here, I would actually look at going back to basics. You know, what does the brand stand for? What are the brand values? As long as you are sticking true to your brand values, and it is a part of what you stand for, then I don't see it being seen as a situation we are trying to milk the situation over here. So you have to take care that you have to true to your values. You certainly can't doing something you were not doing earlier. That is one. Second is, at point of time, these are situations that nobody has thought that would ever come. So the mindset and the mindset of people itself is also fairly, I would say, they themselves are not very sure what is happening or how to react to it. At this point of time, if you're seen as a brand which is trying to milk the situation and do something which is not to be done, you would obviously be seen in a negative light. On the other hand, if you are able to do something which you meaningfully are able to do, so it is not just about doing movement marketing. It is actually, are you doing something about it as a brand? If you are doing something about it which is remains true to your attributes, then you should definitely go and do it. But don't just do it for lip service and don't just do it for movement marketing.
Agree.
Let me give you one example. Now, what demonetization was for these digital payment apps, I think lockdown is for the edutech apps right now, in a very basic way. So Byju's, very smartly, I mean very nicely also, as soon as the lockdown was announced, they made their app open for everybody for, I think, the next 2 months. Now I saw a report saying that there's been a 150% rise in the number of new users on their app. Now, would you see a situation like this to be an opportunistic one or something as which was very helpful as a marketer and a consumer?
So, as a parent, if you see, one of the biggest challenges that parents are facing is keeping the kids occupied. Also ensuring that they are also, because it is very easy for kids to go into watch TV and being on net and do a lot of binge watching, into kids also. So how do I ensure as a parent that my kids are engaged and as they are meaningfully engaged in something that is adding value to them? I think it was a very good one out of Byju's for moving from a certain section which is paid to moving it free.
Mm-hmm.
Give them enormous goodwill, but more important is get more new users to their platform who in turn will get into a paid subscription at a later stage. I think it's a smart move. I'll come back to what I was saying earlier. What are you doing about it? Not just doing a lip service. Are you meaningfully doing something around it? I think Byju's has done that.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Amit, would you like to comment?
Yeah. You know, I really believe in what our previous panelist said, that, you know, just doing things and taking advantage of situation is definitely a complete no-no. Mm-hmm. See, Demon at least had two sides to it. There are people who are supporting Demon and people who are against Demon. This is one situation where the entire world is suffering. There is no one who's going to benefit from this. It's a global disaster. It's a global pandemic. And so we all have to be sensitive towards people's feelings. There are people who are suffering. The world is right now in a complete standstill mode. So I think what we're seeing also, if you look at last year's IPL 2019 IPL finals, the viewership was 13 crores. And if you look at PM Modi's address last time for the lockdown, it was 20 crores. So the seriousness people have towards this entire thing can be evident from the number of people who have tuned on to it. And I really think during this time, brands have to be conscious. Brands have to try to help the community. So if you look at most of these streaming apps, a lot of apps are giving content free.
Right.
Like giving content free, there's content for entertainment, there's content for education, there is content which can be, because right now at home, people are limitation. So I think what can a brand do to try to bring happiness, bring positivity, and bring a diversion in people's sorrow right now, I think is going to be very crucial. And brands which have the platform and the ability to do that should definitely go and do such things, because a short-term sacrifice right now will be a huge brand-building exercise in the coming times. So I think every brand which has a social platform wherein they can try to engage with consumers and try to be meaningful to them without hard selling, I think right now is need of the hour. And we're seeing a lot of brands are doing this. Even auto brand, like I was just seeing BMW, the way they're trying to engage with the customers and trying to... So the whole thing was the joy of buying a car. Now, currently joy is missing in home life. So how can I make the... How can I make something joyful for them? Sharing motivational stories, videos, but not hard selling and not trying to do any sales push right now, I think is what branding should be about. And I think every brand has to right now understand the seriousness of the situation, be sensitive, and being able to, in some way, try to bring happiness in this entire gloomy atmosphere.
You spoke about automobile brands, and my next question is to you, Mr. Jha. Now, yes. For most brands, I think, except maybe FMCG to an extent, there's absolutely no way of ensuring that the purchase cycle is complete.
Yes.
Especially automobiles. Now, let me ask you, considering that you literally stopped production for some time till this lockdown gets over and done with, what do you do as a brand? Do you continue in the mass media and you try and engage with the people to some extent, or you completely disappear till you can actually start selling your brand again?
No. So we have not disappeared. We are not using mass media because, like you said, we can't sell cars, people can't buy cars right now. What we're doing is engaging with our customers using social media and digital. Also trying to help people. Like it was said earlier, that this, when you can't earn money, at least you can earn goodwill by doing certain things for your existing customers, as well as your channel partners and employees. So that is what we are focusing right now on. So what we've done, for instance, is that we have extended the deadline for our customers whose annual service whose warranty claims and all were getting were expiring in the month of March and April. We've extended the deadline so that they don't feel the pinch when business comes back to normal. It's not their fault that the workshop is shut right now. So those are things. Plus, we're also trying to help our channel partners, because it's not just the company with its 5,000 employees. Our channel partners across the brands of the group have thousands and thousands of employees who are dependent on this one brand. So we are trying to do a lot for them also and helping our channel partners. Plus also for employees, for instance, training. this is the time when you're at home. A lot of people are doing work from home, but there is only this much you can do from home. So what we're doing is utilizing this opportunity for training them on certain things for which we either don't find the time or the inclination during normal course of work. So like I said, if you can't earn money, at least you can earn goodwill by doing these things. And yes, don't disappear completely. So we also have social messages on distancing, on keeping your cars clean and how to sanitize your cars if you have to step out, mm-hmm. and how to maintain your car, because if your car is parked for 3 weeks, there could be some damage to it. How can you keep your car protected in this time? Plus, for instance, for doctors, I was just telling before the session started that we went to our database and we have close to 8,000 doctors on our database who are Skoda customers. We have reached out to all of them through our dealers, and dealers are working with local administration for special permissions so that if these doctors need help with their cars, our dealerships can arrange people to go and service their cars, because doctors need to move. They have to be mobile. So these emergency services, as we call it, is what we're doing to help our people right now. Selling cars is something which will not happen till the lockdown is lifted, and we all know about it.
I'll take this opportunity to remind people to please tweet, show us some love, love it, hate it, tweet it. Okay, let me come to Mr. Shukla. You know, Mr. Jai explained how he's trying to keep his brand relevant at such times. Now, there are also brands like Dine Out. You know, the whole purpose behind their brand is to, you know, get people to get out of their homes and, you know, go to the restaurants and eat. Now, these guys are actually coming up with a very reverse kind of a messaging right now, saying that dine out later, stay home now. So is that something that is really going to make the customer respect you? You can do without. It's okay. What do you think?
I think like Tarun mentioned and Abhishek also mentioned, and all of us know, you can't just suddenly disappear from the customer's mind. So there is this question of, somebody said that, you know, if how do you stay relevant when there are no transactions happening, right? So it might sound opportunistic or even otherwise, but I don't think, and particularly those which are purely dependent upon experience, like a dine out kind of service, they can't really necessarily disappear completely from the customer's mind. So even here, and I'm kind of holed up all alone in Trivandrum. So even here, there is a restaurant which I've been once, and they have my number, whatever, in their database. So they have been sending WhatsApp messages, talking about sharing the menu and saying I can order food, and talking about the food is hygienically made and you don't have to worry, and you can. If you don't have facility to cook food, or food is not available, please order, and so on and so forth. So that is also relevant at the same time. So I think it is important for brands not to necessarily disappear. But of course, not make a mockery out of the situation, because it is, as compared to any other moment, it is kind of rather serious.
Sure.
But yeah, I think... Also, the other part is, as long as it is pure charity, and which like Tarun spoke about, and we were not aware till he told us about how he's trying to help doctors and also his dealership employees and so on. As long as you do something and it is, I won't say publicized, but it is disseminated or shared in the media, whether it is mass media or digital or whatever, it doesn't necessarily remain just charity. It is building your brand at the end of the day, and it's a good way of building the brand. So there's nothing wrong with it. But yes, you've got to build it in a sensitive manner, empathetic manner, and not necessarily be too opportunistic. But that's a very fine line, and it's something that one could kind of look at case to case basis. But yeah, one has to be both conscious about the fact that you can't disappear, and at the same time, you can't really be seen as opportunistic.
You know, also in these times, it's kind of difficult to, you know, get agency. I'm talking about the agency side of it. It's very difficult to get your agency to talk, to come up with interesting brand campaigns, you know, again, drawing that line between, you know, sensitivity and actually promoting. So, but they're actually coming up with really good stuff. If you've seen that the ad, the Kalyan Jewelers work, which has Mr. Bachchan and Priyanka Chopra and everybody else, you wouldn't say that it was something that was created from home. So, and done in a record time of less than a week. So yeah. Now that these kind of opportunities are coming up and agencies are actually, you know, putting out work in record time, what does it mean for a marketer? Is this the way to go?
Yeah, so I think it was, it is really stupendous for dwellers brand. And I don't know who initiated the entire process, whether it was soon Piyush Pandey himself or whosoever else or Prasoon Joshi or whatever, because they are personalities in their own right, and I'm sure they can they have the wherewithal the connect with Amitabh Bachchan and so on and so forth. What I heard about, it was informed that in fact it was their idea in line with Amitabh Bachchan, and which is how they could get all the celebrities together, and they would have perhaps conjectured that they would have perhaps approached Kalyan Jewelers. Or since Amitabh Bachchan is a brand ambassador for Kalyan, he would have suggested Kalyan Jewelers to kind of bear the bill and the cost and all that. But I think it's a massive thing for Kalyan Jewelers. You know, in a certain manner, not just the recall, but in a certain manner, you have all the biggies of the entire film industry kind of endorsing you in a certain sense. Not only Amitabh Bachchan, but even biggies who hardly come as brand ambassadors, including Rajnikanth and Mohanlal and Mamutti. I mean, almost everybody was there, right? If you have to go and even kind of look at them for a day, it would cost you some billions. So I think it's something really good for Kalyan Jewelers. Of course, and I would say that they need to build upon this, take this further, because that's something that kind of will, given the barrage of communication going on, even that would get forgotten in some time. But they need to build upon it. But I think it's a massive start for them.
And to add to this, I would say after this, whenever agencies will say ki this will take this much time, jab wo itne time mein ho sakta tha to tum kya ko with the not only timelines, but the kind of equipment you need to shoot, as well as the kind of people you need to shoot. This has become a benchmark. I don't know for good or bad for the advertising industry, but it has created a new
benchmark. It is, you're right, because you know, in a lockdown situation, you need to get all the crew, sound people, camera people, makeup people, light people, all those stuff. It isn't really easy. At all.
Guys, keep tweeting on e4mWebinar, please. That's a hashtag. Also, let me come to each of you. What are your learnings from this episode, the COVID-19 outbreak and the lockdown? What are you going to take home from this?
So I think the important learning for all of us here is life is uncertain, and challenges can come from any sides. Most of us think that we can overcome all challenges. But nature has shown that in this such kind of crisis, whatever you plan, everything goes against you. So I think the important thing right now right here is to try to be able to be look at long term. I think it's like a 3-year period. Short term for me is 6 months. Don't make too long plans. Try to keep plans for short term plans for 6 months, long term plan for three years. And other important thing is the way people would adapt to new changes. It is phenomenal. If you read the data, the most downloaded app today on social media is Zoom. It's not TikTok today, it is Zoom in India. I realize people moving on to video conferencing so easily, but they have caught on. So I think a new trends, a brand will now have to be really on its toes, be able to follow new trends, accept new trends, and to be able to be flexible enough to be changing the business model as the consumer demand changes. Now, we no longer can take the consumer for granted. We no longer can say that things will be done in a particular way. India has shown that even rural India, urban India, they are very, very fast in changing. And when crisis happens, we get the best out of us. So I think as a brand, what I learned is now to be resilient, to be flexible, and to be forward-looking, but with the eye on the near future. And being able to catch up trends and being able to be a little ahead of the curve. And one more thing, which has come very rightly in this thing is being sensitive. What is being sensitive? People are today appreciating brands which are sensitive, which are humane, and which are caring for its customers. So I think as a market, we will evolve from just pricing and just discounting to being able to look at brand ethos, brand values, and being somebody who's more socially responsible. So I think it's a great time for brand, great time for marketeers, and we should be able to communicate our values to the end consumer. And this will also add to brand building and to a very healthy bottom line.
Mr. Gupta, what would you have to say?
I think सबसे पहली learning, first of all, घर में बहुत काम होता है. It's a lot of work. We never realized even a small keeping a small house in order is such a big work and take. And probably we'll empathize with our domestic health in a much better way after this. So that has been the biggest learning from a personal side, I would say. From a work wise, I was always a non-believer in efficiencies in work from home earlier. But now since we are forced to do that, I am realizing how efficient it is, how decision making has become much more faster. Me and Tarun were discussing. We both have a different points of view on this, but my view has been decision making has been much faster. The meetings have been shorter. The meetings start on time. And therefore, the work has become much more efficient. That is one part. Second part is slightly on the vulnerability side. We are vulnerable. You know, however advances we think that has been made in medical science or anything else, a thing like this can pull all of us down. Mm-hmm. That realization is there. But at the same time, the human spirit, you know, we have figured out a way. And I'm sure as the entire mankind, we will figure out a way to beat this and come out of it even strongly. And the work is still going on. So even while, yes, we are vulnerable, we are also, I would say, undefeatable. Not undefeatable, say, I think we have such a high spirit that we can come back whatever happens. Third is, even in business like us, which I was saying earlier, depends so much on face-to-face interaction. Lot of tools that you can develop in very short time which can actually help in advising people how to go out their work and still get business. We still continue to write policies. People continue to buy insurance policies. And it is not just consumer who are able to buy. Once a customer decides to buy, there's a huge backend work also to ensure that the policy gets issued. Even that is going on very well. And things like customer service or our call centers, which are where customers can call in. And since we don't have call centers operating, all of our operators are working out of home and they are working from their phones. But still, we are able to maintain our service levels. Our tax have actually improved and our NPS scores have improved during this point of time. So it is not so. And this has been a huge learning for us. And that whatever said and done, you always evolve and find out a way to do business.
It's been good for you. In that case, Mr. Jha, what do you say?
I think between Saurabh and Abhishek, they have kind of captured the essence of what's it's taught us. A couple of things important which we've learned is, one is the frailty of human beings. We are not invincible. The other thing which is this crisis has brought out the interdependence that we have in our ecosystem with each other and how we can rally around and find solutions. I'm not blowing our own trumpet, but our factories are producing breathing apparatus and masks and hand sanitizers and helping feed the local community and helping transport people with our ride-sharing apps in Europe and all that. These are not part of our core business, but we just quickly evolved ourselves to provide these services to people. And it's not for publicity. Like most of my colleagues don't even know what my company is doing right now till I told them. But we are doing it. And it's not spending money for gaining publicity or gaining goodwill alone. The we, I think, as a human race, have realized that we have to be together on this planet.
Absolutely. Mr. Shukla.
Yes, so just to flip it around, I won't say learnings, but I would say positive fallouts. Mm-hmm. And Abhishek, Saurabh, and Tarun have already shared, of course, a huge number of positive fallouts, stroke learnings. I would say, except for people who are kind of agenda-driven, human race has actually come closer, like Tarun said. And have realized that there is interdependence. Family as a unit, and I would say that I'm a bit of a nationalist, and I would say a lot of Indian values have come to the fore. So, you know, family as a unit, at least for someone who's kind of holed up all alone, you know, I believe family as a unit has come to the fore. The value of And that's a discussion all of us will remember has been going on for a long time. Generalist versus specialist, that discourse has been going on in this country for a long time. The value of the specialist, whether it is a doctor or a scientist or a technician or a innovator or like Tarun said, even the technicians working in the factories, has again come to the fore, and not just doctors alone. Even bankers, all those who are kind of, as compared to, I would say, a plain and simple IAS or IPS or whatever else. Of course, they all have been doing, making immense contribution, but I would say the value of the specialist. And I would say that I think it's time, about time, that we give them more value. Their compensation and everything must be far more than what it is, and not just at par with the IAS and so on and so forth. So there are quite a few learnings, I would say, that has come around. And in fact, the other thing that all of us would agree that the importance and the value of technology, whether it is digital or whether it is technology at the back end, that has become very important. And one more thing, we spoke about, doing things and not just, advertising and so on and so forth. I think, like Tarun mentioned about their factories, or even I've been following Anand Mahindra Street, they have developed a ventilator and so on and so forth. I have been in automobile industry for 19, 20 years. And in a manufacturing setup, particularly in a lockdown, it is impossible to move things like that. Those things which your assembly line is not really set up to make, so on and so forth. But we still have had liquor companies making hand sanitizers, and automobile companies making ventilators, and towel companies making masks, and so on and so forth. I think the immense learning they have now in terms of agility, in terms of flexibility, in terms of knowing that yes, they can do things. It's a long-term benefit to many of these companies who went around and did all this. Now they can quickly adapt themselves to new stuff. From what they're doing right now, they can go and do something else. I don't think they would be at all afraid of taking up new stuff or doing new things. So I think human race has come together, and we've the resilience and the agility and the flexibility has really come to the fore.
And also tell me, what would be the first thing that you will do once the lockdown is lifted? Mr. Jha, you want to go first on this one? What is the first thing that you will do once the lockdown is lifted?
I have to take my family out for dinner, because day before was my daughter's birthday. Next week is my wife's birthday. Oh. And I think it's a bit unfair. So yeah, the first thing we'll do is go out for a dinner, family dinner.
And as a brand marketer, what would you do?
Well, get the team together for lunch and thank all of them and my agencies, because they've been working tirelessly. Get all of them together for a nice meal and thank all of them, because they've been great in this hard period.
And until how long are you not going to be using work from home?
I don't know. See, once a month is good enough, but staying home for a month is, I think, a bit too much.
Okay. Mr. Gupta, what would be the first thing that you would do after the lockdown is lifted?
grab a beer in a bar.
Not a bad idea.
In a bar and get a beer. I think that is something that it is not like that. You do it every 15 days. It's been only 15 days of lockdown. But since you can't do it right now, you suddenly miss much more, and you really want to do it now. But I fully agree with what Tarun said, that we will peak the team that has rallied behind and done some things which could not have been done earlier. I would love to take the team out and my agency partners out for a lunch and thank them for the work that they have done. That's the first thing.
Interdependence has really, really like outshone and, you know, literally become the thing of the need of the hour, and everybody's really respecting that for a change now. Mr. Shukla, what would your idea of a perfect thing to do would be after the lockdown? Also as a marketer, also as an individual. Mr. Shukla?
Yeah, sorry, I kind of dropped out. Sorry, can you repeat the question?
I'm saying, what would be the first thing that you do once the lockdown is lifted? As a marketer.
Yeah.
Because I think the beer analogy was for everybody. So that's out.
Yeah. Agreed. So that's by default. But as a marketer, yeah, the first thing I do is, and that's an advantage, or that's the, now the, I would say the tailwind that I have now is to push through all my agenda in terms of getting the technology in place. So, you know, the context is that here in our organization, we are dealing with the common man, actually even lower than the common man. This thing is that, you know, we need to serve the customer physically and personally and so on and so forth. So the investment behind technology has been kind of brushed under the carpet for a long time. Of course, because there are always resource crunch. But I think this will help me in pushing those things to there are various such investments that we have to make in analytics, in CRM, and various other tech and digital related things. It will help me do that. So the moment, in fact, we have already started pushing things and telling people, come on now. Now is time. So hopefully that'll be done.
You know, there was this very interesting question that just popped up. One of the viewers has written, do you see rural marketing becoming important considering that a lot of people have moved back to villages now, back to their hometowns?
So it's kind of category specific. And I think sooner or later, those people are going to come back to wherever they may be. But as we all know, it's not possible for such a large population to kind of stay in the villages. Not enough opportunity as such. So those people will move to. But you know, there are brands. For instance, I was with Hero Motocorp for a long time, and more than 50% of our sales comes from villages, and not just, you know, not rural in terms of definition, but actual villages come from villages. So that continues to be perhaps a predominant source. Talking about two wheelers, they are moving back to personal transport and not use public transport. So that is one of the trends that we're going to see. So I think it'll be good for, let's say, two-wheeler, particularly a commuting kind of bike, it'll be good. So I think for that kind of category, for remote and whosoever else is there, it'll be good to go back and connect with the rural populace.
What about you, Mr. Jha? I mean, how does it work for the automobiles here on?
See, for us as a brand, we are not present in too many rural markets, to be honest. We are a very metro and big city brand till now. What we started last year was going out as a branch concept into tier 3 and tier 4 cities also. It's too premature to comment on that one also. We'll have to wait and watch and see, because we are not hardcore into rural marketing. Yes, certain categories, for certain categories will be important, but not so important for us as a brand. Certainly two-wheelers, yes, because they have a very, very huge market. Certain four-wheelers also. But we'll have to wait and watch and see how it turns out.
Mr. Gadgil, can I get you in here? You know, there was another question that came in which said, you know, what is, where does the current situation leave traditional mediums like radio and newspaper?
See, I think newspaper today, if you look at most of our urban cities, we're not getting physical newspapers. We're getting emails, PDF forms, and people are happy reading it. This trend, I think, may even continue ahead. People may not really now be used to reading newspaper physically every day. Maybe newspapers for me, I think, could be a weekend activity where you have a full-fledged newspaper on a weekend. People may have time to browse it, and advertisers may be able to really portray all the ads on the weekends. But I think weekdays newspapers is looking for a sea change. Radio, I think, is here to stay because people will have to commute once locked, you know, once things become normalcy. People's commute to workplaces is going to happen. And like you all are saying right now, we can't keep on working from home. We'll have to go to our respective workplaces. We'll have to travel. So radio as a medium is going to be there. I'm hoping radio becomes more interactive, more complete. Not just entertainment, but news start coming on radios. It becomes live. And I think radio is going to be a medium which all advertisers, you know, be it FMCG, auto, will be looking at it because it caters to a wide range of audience. It caters to almost the entire working population, male, female. It caters to a lot of young people. But I think newspapers has its own bit of share of risk attached to it. Even cost-wise, the printing cost of newspapers is gone up so high that advertisers would really look at today's times to connect to audience. There are much better platforms. In my view, the social media platforms, OTT platform will become a very, very big source of media entertainment. In coming times, people would not want to watch cable television, they want to see OTT as per their requirement. So I think that's going to be a potent market for advertisers to display their products. Product launches would be virtual online. We are in jewelry, we are talking about a lot of things now being done also online. And omni-channel, which was just a dream in jewelry, will now very soon become a reality where your entire showroom will be showcased online. People may be able to browse jewelry online, and just the decision of the payment of money can be done physically. But I think the entire selection process will be done online. So a lot of brands which are traditionally being used to newspapers, being used to traditional advertising, will look at this whole phenomenon changing. And I personally am for it that, you know, as we are looking at this, COVID has changed a lot of habits of people, and even a lot of elderly people who are not on social media have logged on. They're enjoying this whole experience. And I think it's here to stay. We are in a virtual world. It's here to stay. And I think every brand will have to look at it seriously. And we have to make strategies around that. So advertising as a whole concept, as a whole reach, is going to change. And we all have to really wait and watch and keep on keeping our plans very flexible and wait and watch how things evolve. I personally am very much focused on digital, on social. I think that's the future.
Now, Mr. Gadgil just spoke about, habits changing. Mr. Gupta, do you think, this whole COVID episode will lead to an increase in the number of insurance policies bought, considering that people are going to, be afraid about their health here on?
Absolutely, absolutely. In fact, we have been discussing about what demonetization did to payments and therefore what this situation is doing to education apps and video streaming apps. I think one industry that will benefit, or I would say will gain specific immensely out of this, is the insurance industry. You know, insurance always been has a, especially life insurance has always been a category which is sold and not bought. But once this is over, people have started realizing how vulnerable we are, how unpredictable life is, and how we cannot plan for everything. So once this realization comes, automatically the one of the mitigating products for all these factors is life insurance. So people will realize life insurance is important, and we hope that from being a hardcore push product, this will bring in some level of pull within this product where people will buy it definitely on their own. We think, and we as a industry, as a company, we are fully prepared for this, but we see a lot of silver lining coming out of this situation.
Mr. Jha, do you see any silver lining here? It's been a terrible, terrible year for your industry.
The auto industry is waiting for a silver lining for a while. It will take some time because ours, our industry is largely dependent on two factors. One is absolute requirement for transport, which is when you buy a car. And for a lot of brands, it's also a reward that you give to yourself for doing well in life and all that. Upgrade, especially when you buy bigger cars, fancy cars, premium cars, luxury cars, you're rewarding yourself. We have to wait and see how the people who are going to reward themselves, how harsh they are on themselves and all that. Because a lot of these customers of ours are also entrepreneurs, run their own businesses. I think they will also look at bringing the business back on tracks, you know, paying salaries for the people and coming back to normalcy, which might affect the demand in the short term, at least. But in the long term, there is still a lot of pent-up demand in this country. We have one of the lowest penetrations for automotive in the world. So there will be a demand. It will take some time to settle down, but in the long run, it will. We can't predict the exact timelines. I wish we could, but it would.
Okay, let me ask this one question. I think this is an agency guy for sure. This has come in the Q&A session. He wants to know, how do I get the clients to spend now? Nobody's spending. Mr. Shukla, do you want to answer that?
Well, that's an opportunistic stance. So it's like saying the brands asking the same question to the customers and saying, why don't you spend? Why are you not buying this dress or this t-shirt or this jeans or this car or this whatever? So I don't think we can ask the customers as of now, and I don't think the agency should be asking us. Maybe the way is to, you know, get relevant stuff out. A lot of initiative has to be taken from everyone. Get the relevant stuff out in terms of keeping the brand conversation with its customers alive. Like we said in the beginning, that nobody wants to just really disappear at this point in time. And if that works, of course, it'll be kind of disseminated, and whatever comes out of it will come to the agency and will come to all of us. But doing it in a planned manner, basically to do advertising as such, I think that's kind of, as of now, out of question.
And also tell me, what kind of challenges will brands see after the, you know, everything is settled and we're back to normal? What kind of challenges do you foresee in the immediate future?
So, I think it's one thing that I wanted to say for some time now in this discussion is, if you ask me, we've just kind of started on this COVID thing. It's a long haul, lest we think otherwise. And until we have a specific proper cure, a la a vaccine or whatever it is supposed to be, and it is freely and easily available, and it shows real results and without any side effects and so on and so forth, people in their minds, in terms of the emotions, are not necessarily going to return to normal. For how long one doesn't know that we will keep ourselves restricted like this, whether it is in India or outside. And the moment, travel is opened and international flights kind of go on and so on and so forth, you might as well see, for example, yesterday or day before yesterday, there were reports about the fact that China has seen recurrence in terms of imported virus, infection, because they've opened up and so on and so forth. So unless and until, things really return to normal, which I don't see at least a year or so, we all of us have said, let's not plan too much. So we should wait for it. The other thing is, all of us are talking as per our, of course, we have experience and that also matters, but we haven't really gone out and spoken to the customer as yet. Of course, it is not the time to speak to the customer, but we got to speak to the customer, do our classical marketing research, whichever way we want to do it, whether we want to do it online or offline or whichever way. I think we need to speak to the customers when they're in a mood to kind of respond and get to know as to what they're thinking and what they're doing. And it is only then can we say, okay, this is what, But yes, otherwise we can continue to do the fundamental stuff, like you said, you know, being in technology, being in digital, and so on and so forth. But from a consumer perspective, there is still time for us to, learning is not enough as of now for us to really plan.
And there is another question that came in. He says, Kalyan Jewelers obviously has come up with this one ad which has got everybody's attention. Now, of course, there are a lot of other brands which are not openly advertising, coming up with videos. In the long run, do you think those people will be left behind? Or it's okay that they don't advertise in the icon? Mr. Jha or Mr. Gupta, whoever wants to answer this.
See, I have to advertise for an audience to be ready to receive my advertising. I can't be advertising. And also answering to the previous question, that in a lockdown state where you can't step out of your building, what do I advertise for? And we don't even know whether it's this is being lifted on 15th. It might be 30th. It might be next month or 3 months. So who would like to waste money right now and effort on customers who are not willing to take that message from you? So I think we'll have to wait and watch. And very rightly said, this is just the beginning. We've just got into it 2.5 weeks. We still don't know the entire implication. We are at the early stages, and we have to speak to the customer and understand what they need. We can't force a customer to buy a car at this point of time, or buy, yes, insurance. Maybe we can force them to buy it, but definitely not cars at this point of time.
So let me conclude, if I may. Whatever the situation now, let's hope that years later, when we look back at this particular phase, we don't say that, hey, it was all bad. Let's try and find that one silver lining, and soon, for each of our sake. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Brands do well in the months to come.
Thanks.
Thanks so much.
Nice talking to you, everyone.
Everyone stay safe.
Thank you.